Welcome back. This is part 11 of our galactic history. I'm Lance White with Andrew Partsis. And one of the things that came up for me during the break was the numerous wars. Are those being planned out as part of the final chess moves, or are some of that unexpected? The wars that are going on right now around the world, what's the game plan with that?
There are unexpected things happen. An example, the fruit vendor in Tunisia. He was an unexpected wave of rebellion, totally against the entire system that was looking at our data and predicting us to do this. The guy in Tunisia, he was a fruit vendor who said he had to pay taxes or have some kind of license, and he set himself on fire in the square, which set off a whirlwind of stuff in Tunisia, Egypt, Afghanistan, all over the Middle East, up into Syria. But that one fruit vendor, what was being protested was actually food issues. Price mm-hmm. of food had tripled.
Oh.
The price mm-hmm. of olive oil had gone through the roof, and that's the staple of the staple for them.
Yeah.
The same thing in Egypt. Egypt was about the price of food.
Mm.
Okay? That's how out of touch they were. They had raised the price of food so much so people could no longer eat that were in middle-income jobs.
Which is happening here in America.
Yes.
In fact, it's happening very rapidly.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're trying to take our water away from us and make it pay for it, too.
Right. They've already taken the air.
Mm-hmm. As for the wars, we see Tunisia. Tunisia fell. As Tunisia was rising, the main controller forces looked at this and said, this is gonna suck for us. We have to do something quick. So they divested all of their assets out of Iraq and Afghanistan and put them in Tunisia so that they could co-op any rebellion move that was going to go, because they knew it was going to spread. It goes to Egypt in the beginning, and then you have the Green Movement in Iran. Egypt was still a little blip on the radar in Tahrir Square. They'd only been there like 6 or 7 days. And then you have what's going on in the Green Revolution. The Green Revolution would be the 2 months before, would be before Christmas.
Okay.
The Green Revolution, they're in their run-up to their election. Millions are out. They pull out the guns. They start killing people in the street. It's live on TV. So that tells you that the government is going to suppress rebellion.
Right.
That's the media outlook. This was actually shown here for a reason. Think of how many of the wars aren't shown to us. The war in Turkey and Syria is going on now. Do they show that any day at all?
No.
But they showed the Green Revolution, the people getting killed in the streets for a reason.
Was that to turn us against Iraq?
That was fear.
Ah, well,
to create fear.
Right.
They already divested all their forces out of Iraq. They realized they already lost. Now the tribes want them. They want them there, and they wanted prosecutions for their war criminals on the American side. Plus all the corruption and the fact that $4.5 trillion is missing from Reconstruction.
What else is new on that?
The bribery went to the highest levels there.
Ah.
So Iraq was divested because they got all the technology they wanted out from under the ground. There's all sorts of technology that they need. Afghanistan's a little different. There are actually vessels embedded in the mountains.
Mm-hmm.
They're out of phase in the mountains that have been there for millions of years. And they're extremely valuable vessels on the black market. Very valuable. Or the technology in them is so intense that it can increase the power of one faction a lot.
Wow. And so do they know where these...
You have to go search for them, literally. It's like quite on a low scale level. You have to be like actual psychic people in the spot to understand how to pull the vessel out, because the vessel has a limited consciousness in it.
Huh. Interesting. And there must be numerous places in Egypt and devices
all throughout the whole world.
Well, right. Yes.
All throughout the whole world.
Right. So the dark hasn't discovered all these items.
Nor has the light.
Okay.
But people purposely left those there so the future people would find them.
Right, like the Dead Sea Scrolls, for instance?
Correct.
Okay. And what was Area 51 about? Was that...
Area 51 is where the time travel missions needed an anchor location so that they can go and get missions anytime they were in the time stream. So let's say you got put back 30 years.
Okay.
If you needed an update and didn't want to communicate to anything but something that has connection to the timeline you came from, you'd go to Area 51, with a special passcode which would take you to the time travel division.
Wow. What else exists there?
Everything we talked about.
Right. Because all these technologies are there.
But at the same time, a lot of their technologies have been removed. They figured out a way how to get past their suppression fields and just teleport all the technology they wanted out.
Where to where?
The good guys took it out.
I got it. So in other words, the toys of the big boys are being...
Taken away. Israel has been hurt pretty bad that way.
Okay.
Much of their multidimensional technology has been completely incapacitated. They still have tricks up their sleeve, but the stuff they expected to have until the end isn't there. Think of both knights and all your pawns are gone.
Okay.
That's where Israel is right now.
Wow. It does feel like they're on their last legs.
You never know.
But they all reinvent themselves.
They
come back somehow. They come up with a new... Or they have an ace in the sleeve.
Exactly.
You know,
or a gun in their sleeve.
Too many of those.
Exactly. So, the Syrian war.
Yeah, what about that?
All the wars that exist right now on our planet are meant to suppress the chakra energy that's below it.
Oh.
There are a cluster of womb chakras all throughout the Middle East, called the Garden of Eden at one point in the Bible. What it meant is there could be thousands of local realities within that zone that were all birthing new life that could be transported to a new blank Akashic record planet. It was life that was meant to rapidly be created and then sent somewhere else. What's happening there now is war, so every time someone dies, they're instantly recycled back into the system of war. So you could die once and all of a sudden be forced to be a walk-in on somebody else who's dying.
Ooh. That could get pretty tiring.
And that is what's suppressing the energy of the chakras from waking up. These will be the first sets of chakras that wake up and begin to change the people in that area. And that's why there's war there. And that's why the rebellion started with a fruit vendor, because that was the first opening of the collection of those chakras.
So once that energy starts to circulate, it seems like there's almost nothing that could stop it.
Correct.
Once a wild card
is played
outside of the predictive models comes in,
all the old models don't mean the same value.
Right, and they can't keep up with them fast enough, no matter how much technology they have,
correct,
to predict what's going to come next.
Exactly.
And so that kind of would level the playing field to some extent.
It would put the neutrality people back in a place where they can create secrets that the light and the dark don't know about, which can make the game play faster.
Okay, all right.
And once the game plays faster, you have to show more of your moves.
Right. So the neutrality people are the ones that really...
Step on the gas pedal.
You're right. And those are...
The walk-ins,
okay.
They're brought in by Prime Creator, his choice, because he's scanned everyone that's on this planet and understands what other service to universe entities are ready to step in and take the hardest job ever, which is to take over the contracts of people at the controller levels to end a system of domination and control that's been going on in a 52 million year time war history.
Wow.
Yeah.
And a 38,000 year suppressed ascension cycle.
Yeah.
So, I just lost my train of thought. We were talking about the walk-ins. So that completely changes the whole game.
Correct.
Because the walk-ins are the Council of 12.
Correct. And their management system.
Management system. Okay.
And the court system, the spiritual court system,
which is run by the Archons.
Run by the Archons.
And the Archons also manage what else?
The control rooms.
Ah.
They have their puppetry energy over the control room people.
Okay. So they don't have to manage the control rooms directly. They manage the people in them.
Correct.
And then the people in the control rooms manage the...
people below them.
Which...
are the bankers.
Ah, okay. And then the next layer down below that...
the bankers control the governments.
Right. Okay. And then...
the governments run the strings of the thugs.
Right. And then the mafia runs interference for all of them. Yeah. And the royals kind of...
hold the contracts so the system exists, because there has to be contract holders for the system.
Okay, right. So
they're the ones that hold the paper.
right. They own the world.
Exactly.
And then the Vatican?
Holds the paper over the soul contracts. People are in the baptized situation.
Now, the purpose of baptism is to keep the
soul... Put you in that contract of tacit consent forever.
So, getting baptized is not necessarily a good thing. That's where they seal the spirit from...
Yes, but at the same time, there are people that are healed from baptism. And this is, again, to get to religion. There are good people in religion.
Right.
Religion is hijacked, and there are bad people in religion, thus the pedophilia organizations. But there, for religion to be what it is, there has to be good in it. Otherwise, nobody would have ever bought it.
But to what extent
the
is
the highest ends?
The highest levels have to
are
be
government, which are separate of religion.
Well, okay, all
so
right.
The governing body of the church, which is the Vatican, is a country that has people that have citizenships all over the world. So you'd see the duality of the Vatican. It's a country that holds the spiritual contracts of a religious organization that's global.
Mm.
And forcibly spreading and passively spreading,
mm-hmm.
versus other religions that are forcibly and passively spreading also.
Okay, like the Mormons.
The Buddhists.
But, so right, any of them. They're all, promoted. Any religion
they're
is...
They're all promoted.
Yeah, promoted, yeah. So there's no one better than another. And then that brings us to the sacred texts that you said were all basically holographic documents that... And
co-opted after or before their written.
Right, it would have to
because it's about passing the generations and allowing the generation to reinterpret based off of the predictive models they have, and if something goes wrong, they can fix it the next generation and print it the way they want it.
Right, they just put the 11th printing or whatever, or they erase it. Erase it, and then you don't even know that what you're holding is a different version mm-hmm. because the old one doesn't exist anymore.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Okay, now what about a... physical, there's a lot of controversy about Jesus and his life and what he did and who he was and so on and so forth. Now, as I understand it, everything that manifests at the metaphoric level has to also, or as above, also has to exist as below. So there has to be a physical manifestation of 12 disciples or 12 people, whether they're, literal or not, and there has to be somebody that incarnates as a being that it represents, and many people have felt that they are that particular being, and that has to do with the God program?
God programming, or you at one point were a sovereign piece of that entity that chose to become part of Earth consciousness instead of taking on a body or going to the astral world. It went total to service to Earth, and it's allowing its name and imagery of that other lifetime to go through time. And then there will be future people that will look at that energy and recognize that at one point I was 25 degrees of separation that person.
Okay.
But you're not really that person.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
It's like saying my great-grandfather times 52 that I lived one life in time next to is me, but they're not.
Right.
Their energy is so powerful that it goes through the bloodlines.
Right. And now, what can we find out about the actual person that lived and those,
He was a real person.
Okay.
The trivial stuff in the Bible, and then there's the more expansive stuff in the Bible. He wasn't on the cross.
Okay, right. I've always thought that.
Trying to be a little delicate, because I know some of the audience out there is really connected to some of these concepts.
Yeah.
He wasn't tortured.
Right.
Okay. He was betrayed, but not in the way that the Bible was stated.
Okay.
His betrayal was by other light beings, actually.
Really?
Other light beings who didn't want to see the bastardization of the teachings.
Okay.
So they said, you gotta go.
Huh.
You gotta go.
So would
they're screwing up our system of light while the dark was still trying to win.
So they said Jesus had to go?
They made sure that it was not the right time for him to stay.
Oh, interesting. Interesting.
The light forces are not unified.
Oh, right. That's pretty clear.
Make that clear. They are not unified.
That's pretty clear. You can see that in the New Age movement, and of course that's all been co-opted in the Lightworker.
Correct.
The fragments.
Jesus was a real being that traveled the world and also traveled the stars.
Some say he went to Egypt for a lot of his esoteric training.
And the Himalayas and Japan.
Oh, nice.
And Australia.
Wow.
And Native America.
Wow.
Mesoamerica, South America, Asia, all over.
So he was able to travel anywhere.
He used the Hollow Earth of Garth and Tooth Networks.
Interesting. Interesting. Did he, in his journeys...
There were many mystics in throughout the Middle East that knew how to use the tunnels.
Okay.
Okay. As well as those in the Vatican, because there's Vatican-based tunnels also.
Oh, right. And then there are maglev trains underneath...
These are consciousness trains.
Right? Oh, okay.
There are maglev trains, too, but these are actually tunnels that once you start traveling, you go into no time, and if you're going from one continent to another, it can take a day instead of months.
Okay. Okay, good.
He was also big in Ireland, too. He did a lot, Jesus did a lot of work in Ireland, too.
I've heard that Ireland is the center or the source of much of the, of much of what has come out spiritually that has been repressed.
Yes, because there was a massive DNA, how do I put this, bank that was there. It was the crystals that held the wisdom of all the DNA separate of the wisdom of the domination and control
of nature.
The free earth system had powerful connections in the base soul family, so people were able to transmit codes, the soul codes that I've been talking about, to these basically off-the-record recordings, so that someone would have access to it in the future.
Okay.
Jesus was able to help organize that.
Wow.
Because there were individual families that had individual parts, and when he came there as his teacher, he began healing people in unity. As began people in unity, they all break and bring their crystal to the table.
Oh.
And that's ultimately why the Vatican was very harmful to the Irish people.
Oh.
Because it was looking for those people that held those objects so that they could erase them or bring them back into the Vatican.
And they did accomplish that.
Correct.
Veronica Keane talks a lot about that. Did you...
I've interviewed Veronica, yes.
Isn't she a wonderful person?
Wonderful, wonderful.
And I love her channeling of Montague.
Yes.
And another person, I just adore her, Montague's words through Veronica. And she's doing quite a bit of wonderful work on the planet as well. And Michael Tesserian is another one that's come out with the origins of the Irish origins of...
Yes.
Yeah. And that's another wonderful source of information. Of course, this is a much easier to just tap into the Akashic Records. Okay, so getting back to Jesus. So he was basically one of the highest light beings?
No.
Not necessarily. There are others.
He's the one that got spun.
Ah.
Let's think of political spin factors.
Okay.
He was an ace. He was we'll just call it a royal flush that was played.
Okay.
And then somebody else played a royal flush on the spin game afterwards.
Oh, yeah, this is what it feels like.
Because he got co-opted.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
He was there. He was real. He changed people locally for 2 generations. 14 generations later, it doesn't matter what he said or what he did.
Right. Right.
Because they wrote him 400 years later.
Yeah. And that's what an example of time manipulation.
Correct.
And also changing texts. Yeah.
Changing translations.
Right. For the next generations, which is one of the tricks that, one of many, that's being played on us. Okay.
Changing our history as they see fit.
Right, right, exactly.
And us never knowing it was changed because they took all our oral traditionists.
Right, and we have no clue really about the star families that we come from because that is so suppressed. That information is really, that's been marginalized.
Correct.
So, did Jesus ever have a relationship?
Yes, and children.
And children.
Yes.
What happened to the children?
Broken into 32 family lineages spread among the kings and queens of Europe. That's why they're contract holders for the system of domination and control.
Oh.
And that's why his bloodline was so important to dominate.
Oh.
Because if any others did manifest within his bloodline, they wanted to make sure that there was the soul family that was in there was controlled.
Right.
Thus,
right.
That's why you have a queen now who's the sole contract holder for the monetary value system of exchange.
Huh.
That's what the Queen of England does.
Wow.
She holds all those soul contracts.
Wow.
Therefore, she has to be a powerful and old soul and has to go through a remembering process.
So what's going to happen with the royal families as the shift increases?
Well, when you start taking away the spin, people will be real angry at them. But at the same time, many of them had no choice. They're just born into a life holding contracts that they have no way of understanding.
Did they have a choice of being born into these?
Maybe 1,000 lifetimes ago.
Oh, right. And like the rest of us, they too have had to keep replaying their roles over and over. And so some of those are probably pretty weary.
Yes.
Even though they have all the keys and to the toys and everything else. Yeah. They're tired of...
They know they can never defeat the controllers. They've lost hope inside themselves, therefore just play the game.
Ah, right, right. Interesting. So, all of Jesus' lineages has been co-opted into the bloodlines?
No, there's a couple bloodlines that are still in secret.
Okay. And the esoteric groups, the various secret groups that are holding, the Rosicrucians and the Masonics and so on and so forth, and all the secrets, the skull and bones and the rest of it, are holding the tech, also holding the technology at the higher levels.
And spirit contracts.
And the spirit contracts. Right. So they have...
They have to actually have beings that hold the contracts physical on Earth for the system to exist. Think of the system itself as holding contracts to millions of controllers.
Wow.
And for the system to exist, there actually has to be a physical being in the matrix holding all the contracts in unity with all the other contract holders for the system to actually exist on top of our incarnation grid, why it's hijacked.
Whew. So that's a lot of layers.
Yes.
And so once that's all removed, once the matrix is no longer functioning as the matrix and the contracts are not null and void, then we are free and sovereign. Mm-hmm. And the incarnation and the incarnational process returns to an organic process through Gaia Sophia.
Correct.
And there's a system of courts,
spiritual courts of equity, with all your ancestors present, and the proper family lineage members as the judges, with Earth overseeing the judges through unity consciousness.
Okay, that seems like a good plan to me. Mm-hmm. I'm all for it.
That's right. Me too.
So. So what do people do to hop on the bandwagon to accelerate this
process?
Reclaim
your sovereign free will.
Right.
So much about it. Nurturing yourself. I call that the hard work, nurturing yourself.
Yeah.
Nurturing yourself so that you can heal others or heal yourself or find yourself in an opportunity to expand and explore your own consciousness. Mm. I'm the only galactic historian out there. We need more. I'm talking to you guys out there. We need you to say yes.
Are you going to be able to...
Teach others?
Yes.
At some point that will be made available.
Okay.
The other two that still have their choice haven't been given their opportunity yet.
Okay.
But there are others that have seen what I've done and are going to make their own version of it.
Okay.
It'll come out and affect people within their soul family. They may not have the complete soul codes that I do, but I will complete enough for them that... Their understanding is there's many new soul families in this system right now, and then there's a graduating class that's going to come in with a totally different set of soul codes. So they're working with the soul codes that are in the class that's about to come in.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the people that would be, 3 or 4 degrees of separation away from me, where I have a complete soul code to what's living here now. But I don't have the complete soul code to what's about to migrate in.
So
the two of us will cross over information-wise and soul code-wise, and then they'll be able to work in the astral world to complete the soul codes of everyone coming in.
And then those who graduate, and that's a time of celebration.
Called the kegger party.
The kegger party, thank God, we can drink again. Then that's when we're also able to work with some of the spiritual technology that has been available, and that the galactics and...
Clothing will be big.
Clothing.
Specialized clothing that amplifies your psychic energies.
Oh, never right. That's a great idea. I like that one. That's a good one. What else?
You'll have integrated artificial intelligence access, so you can figure out how to make personal mental programs for yourself.
Oh.
To get things accomplished.
Okay.
There won't be a monetary system, but everything will be overseen by the Earth's consciousness, so there will be no scam artists, no telemarketers.
And no secrets.
No secrets.
So there won't be anybody pulling anything on anybody, and that will be a permanent state.
Correct. And then people will get to heal in that energy and be able to make extend circles of trust with other people that they never could have before, because there was always the fear of the scam or the lie, or
right.
which was always in their subconscious.
Right. Right.
Because the system is so corrupt.
And all the fear programming
goes away.
Goes away.
And it takes time to heal. I've said this many times before, we're going to need 1 billion healers here.
So those healers are us.
Us.
And we have to step up to the plate and learn first how to heal ourselves.
Yep.
Because you can't heal somebody else till you heal yourself.
And if somebody else doesn't want to be healed, you can't make them.
And you can't make them, right. You're going against their, okay. But in the new energy, it seems like there will be a large group of people that will seek healing.
Correct.
Just as there are hungry people.
Many of them will get it just through pilgrimages, like here to Mount Shasta.
Okay.
The places of power will begin doing their jobs once again at the highest levels.
So all of the sacred spots will be loosened up, so to speak?
Heavily charged with energy.
Okay.
Waiting for us to come there to be the bees that pollinate the energy and take it away.
Wow. And so all of these pilgrimages to various places, there will be your local area restored.
Right.
And will there be new grids and ley lines created by the...
The existing grids and ley lines will allow to go back to their natural positions.
Oh, okay.
And there will be people that will be working for many years erasing the old fake grid.
Okay, and the false sacred geometry.
Correct.
And the false light codes.
Yes, that'll actually be a job of many of the people that want to go in service to Earth.
Okay, so...
Which is disconnecting the sacred geometry city system.
That's a huge task, because
yes,
it's been built up for thousands of years.
Hundreds of thousands.
Hundreds of thousands, right, right. All the city's names, the city streets, everything has been, you know, pretty much...
Pretty much on the multidimensional design.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, well, do you want to share anything else about the... Before we take over...
I want to finish touching on the Syria conflict.
Okay.
As I was saying, they took... all their mind control parts, that it's Al-Qaeda, because Al-Qaeda is an American-created invention.
Right.
That was created by time travelers who trained people outside of time to suddenly become cabal members of the flight, who had to be real and at the same time had to be fake.
Right.
So they move everything out of Syria because they went to Egypt and Libya, and then when the Libya war became to an end, it was about a drug war there and a gold war there. And then all the leftover zealot program agents went to Syria, because Syria's revolution began also. At the same time, Iran began sending its mind control units into Hezbollah to lure Israel out for another fake war event. At the same time, Americans were pounding, we're going into Israel, we're going into Iran. There's two carriers out there and 200 websites saying, the carrier was sunk. No, it wasn't. Okay, there were many multidimensional action fronts on the oceans during the Iran-America chest bumping of 2011 and 2012 and part of our 2013, where the chicken hawks keep trying to beat the war drums.
Oh.
And they're beating the war drums because they're trying to get the machine to wake up and make more war. But the machine's not going to make more war. The recruiters can't get people to go in. And the existing people are leaving... because they don't want to be in it anymore, abandoning it left and right.
Oh, that's something, of course,
then
we don't.
Then you have the companies, because we're so, our unemployment, real unemployment is about 35% here in the United States, even though they're trying to call it 7%.
Right.
It's well into the 30s. Many of those military vets are screwed up. The only option to get is a job back as a private contractor through a military contractor corporation.
Right.
And then you're going off and doing worse things than you were in the military.
Right.
But you're getting paid $150,000 a year.
Right. Right.
Instead of your 32 or 18 that you were in war.
Right. So there's just an increasing degradation of the system that's becoming more
cannibalistic of itself.
Yes, and it's just eating itself like the snake eating the tail.
That's exactly.
Okay. One of the questions I want to ask you in the near future is... about David Wilcock's work on uncovering where the hidden reserves are, the movement of gold around the world, and, you know, what's actually been happening with that. and that there are secret families, and there's another person that I can't think of his name right now, but and Gordon Duff from Veterans Today had said in one of his shows that an American and a Chinese aircraft carrier were shooting
38,000 people in the
good. All right. Well, when we come back, maybe we can talk about the gold and where it's been and who's holding.
There's all sorts of things to deal with the gold.
Oh, yeah.
I just want to remind those people that about the Italian bankers in Switzerland who's found $6 trillion worth of bearer bonds.
$6
trillion? Yeah, that made the news.
Really? I'm out of touch.
We can show the clip as part of the video, actually.
Wonderful.
Yeah,
okay.
CNBC actually had to report that.
That's what seems to be happening, is that they're having to report certain things that are filtering from the underground, you know.
But the thing is, that actual report was the graduating timeline had to have that in it for some of their other plans to exist. That's why they gave it the one consciousness blurb and tried to retract it.
Okay, right. That makes sense.
So they do that frequently.
Yes. Okay, well, stay tuned for more.
Yep.
We'll be back with part 12. Welcome back to our galactic history. This is part 12. This is Lance White with Andrew Bartzis. Hi. Well, we've been talking about wars and events that are not expected in the predictive models. And I'm going to throw a curveball at you because I want to talk about some of the lone gunman events and some of the things that have been going on that everybody's been speculating about. So I want to put them to bed once and for all. Mm-hmm. Who killed President Kennedy?
I've gotten that curveball question.
All right.
Honestly, Kennedy killed himself.
He did?
No. Not literally. He was taken out by a gunman, but okay. It was a multidimensional event.
Okay.
He would have made the event come in the 60s and the 70s.
Oh.
Even if he wasn't in prison, he would have held spiritual contracts that were opposite of the system of domination and control.
Mm.
So his family lineage was collecting spiritual contracts to oppose the forces of domination and control.
Mm-hmm.
So when you have somebody collecting contracts to take your contract right away, what happens up happening to you when you're in the head of the office? You get taken out because their faction had made it all the way to the top. Faction is the key.
Okay.
So you want to know exactly who killed Kennedy?
Well, if it's on the tip of your tongue.
Well, exactly who killed Kennedy is not the way it's written.
Okay.
Kennedy took a shot to the head.
Right.
Which was actually a multidimensional brain popper. On camera. Meant as a fear event. Staged, spun, done exactly the way they wanted to. And in operation of etheric satellites at the same time he's being shot.
Wow.
So everyone was psychically aware when he was shot.
Wow. Well,
the whole world.
Yeah.
And therefore the programming turned on because it was a spun event.
Oh.
Because his faction had used its last chip.
So they were unable to go any further with...
Correct. With freeing the world.
And then at that point it's a matter
Pow.
Of... Yeah. And you know that that's the only... So that's kind of where the forces of domination and control are being positioned now.
Correct.
They backed themselves into a corner, and the only way out is, once you play your last chip,
you're done.
You're done. Yeah, there's eventually...
Unless somebody loans you money.
Which that's, of course, part of the game of domination and control.
Exactly.
Okay, what about John Lennon? Now that I'm asking about people that we...
John Lennon learned how to transcend time while on music. While doing music, and it was the beginning of video recording, and he began having beings show up in the video recordings, and if he was allowed to live, he would have influenced the millions into revolution.
Well, yes, most assuredly.
There you go, and that's why he was taken out.
I heard that Yoko Ono is part of the Illuminati.
No.
Okay.
She's a free will individual that has been abused.
I like her myself. Mm. I mean, I've always felt that she's, she has
A reason the two of them met. They were soul family. They went back to the Lemurian age. And they would have transmitted Lemurian singing technology.
Wow.
It upgraded people's soul codes and DNA just through singing.
Wow. And of course he has children too, Julian and I think a couple of others, so it's not like the game is over for them.
Well,
unless they've
he was a special person.
Yes.
And chose to make his talent very special.
What about George Harrison?
He's a time war sufferer.
Really?
Time traveler many times over.
Oh.
Many times, super soldiers, programmed people, people in domination and control in the sexual abuse industry, they'll force people to watch a certain band or follow a certain band member, and that helps them when they're ripped out of one time stream and put into another, and these old guy bands are still around. They identify to them. They go to those concerts, and then there's people always watching those concerts that can bring them back and shepherd them back into the system.
Oh.
So it's stuff, when you're working with musicians, this is integrated into the system to lure back people, because it's easy to create an obsession for music that gives you a positive benefit.
Right.
And thus that lures you back into the loop.
Right. So I'm guessing that the Rolling Stones are part of that.
Well,
somehow part of that.
They are a part of it, but ironic thing about the Rolling Stones is they create a music that passes generations.
Right.
When you listen to the original recordings of Sympathy for the Devil, you only get what you need. Mm-hmm. It's a totally vibration than the modern recorded ones that are remastered of the new systems. It doesn't have the same 60s power behind it.
Hmm. Hmm.
Because that was recorded during that time frame.
Oh, right, right. What about the Jimmy Savile scandal that broke not too terribly long ago?
Absolute proof that the sexual abuse ring is runs to the highest levels of government and media.
Mm, yes. It's global. Mm. And, in fact,
and it's been around a very, very long
very
time.
Very long time. And I hear that the Netherlands is a hotbed, a nest of, you know,
all throughout
Queen Beatrix.
All throughout Europe, there are
right.
pockets of it. But that's been, that system of pockets of sexual child abuse and slavery has been there for thousands of years also.
So
there are entire communities, that's all that they do.
Right, and everything might look like
normal.
Tulips and roses and things, but
there's people locked in the basement.
Right, right, right. Okay. So that brings me back to some of these other lone gunman events, mm-hmm. which I'm guessing are also multidimensional and time travel.
They're time travelers that are put into a future timeline. As I've been saying, it's all about 2011 to 2014. So all these lone gunmen are secret pieces that have been played unaware of any other faction. No other faction was aware of it. So, example, Sandy Hook. Sandy Hook, you know, the guy that we all see on camera all drugged out.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that guy, that particular person, isn't the actual person that did the mission.
Okay.
He was created and dominated and controlled, put there, and was waited for his time travel code activation to go and do this event there.
Okay.
There was a team waiting there for him to put another dark entity in him that could physically do the killing.
Oh.
And he went there with a team, got the kills in for him himself also, and the rest of the team did that. As they extracted him, one of the team was injured, got scared. He wandered off and then was taken over by the police, who had puppetry entities in them that became part of the team. Because they were free-willed police, and all of a sudden something was inside them, made them did something different.
Wow.
The other people got away. He got blamed. He then is the contract holder for all the fear spin that was done afterwards.
Oh, wow. So that event didn't necessarily go off like it was planned.
No, there was too many people that picked it apart.
Oh, you're right, right.
But listen to the fact that they didn't take into the understanding that there's thousands of people, or hundreds of thousands of people worldwide that listen to police scanners.
Oh. And
there are internet stations that just put the whole thing on. My radio station, freedomslips.com, Revolution Radio, actually has an access to all police band broadcastings throughout the entire world available on their channel.
Nice, nice.
And during the Boston event, all of those went dead silent. Everybody's police scanners went silent.
And so that was part of the technology?
Because they had figured out that people were listening to that.
And
they do things like this. Some of these events are planned to determine how much the resistance of Free Earth
right.
is there and ready to react.
And to find out, you know, how,
right.
yes, how quickly, right. yes. And, of course, all of the major...
And it allows them to test their data.
Right. So it could be no more unusual than a test balloon going up.
Correct.
Okay. And they do that on all the major media like Facebook and all the different social media sites. And that's all pretty much run by artificial intelligence?
And teams of remote influencers.
Okay, so Google and all the major...
Well, the actual people in Google, no, they're separate. These are the franchises that I spoke about in an earlier episode.
Right.
They have access to the raw data that is collected on us from all those social networking data mining sites.
Oh.
That information is then fed into an artificial intelligence that makes a massive computation and makes a predictive model for each individual and then the whole in total. And then remote influencers look at this data and process the data and then begin to target lineages of people through the internet who have an ability to reach far.
Hmm. But some events that have been predicted as being in the future have to be there, but they have a certain amount of...
wiggle space.
Right, right, to adjust and you know, make modulation controls. Okay, that makes sense. The Boston Marathon?
The Sonara Brothers. An absolute perfect example of sleeper cells that have been people that have been taken out of time, mind controlled and given bomb and weapon training, brought back into time with all the equipment that they needed and storage lockers to hide it and passes to be who they were for 3 years, because there was a clone living in the place when they took them out outside of time.
Okay.
And then when they put them back in, the clone that was holding space was given the dominant personality inside them to keep their cover until they were both triggered to do the operation.
Wow. Wow, I'll have to listen to that again. That's a head scratcher.
That's the way they do these cell activations.
Right.
The guy in the Sikh temple, exact same thing. Aurora, same thing, except on a fact that it was designed literally to reach out to the whole world.
And do one of the 15 of the families, or one of the 15 beings, triggered those things?
Orchestrated it from the highest level with its puppetry ability.
Okay. Several of them may have been privy to it.
No, Aurora was one particular being, the one that's in charge of North America.
Oh, okay. So there are there different sections that they're in charge of?
Yes, they've each got their own little
dominion. Okay, and then they coordinate all that information?
Not always.
But
they do coordinate.
With reservations.
Yes.
Okay, I gotcha.
There basically was an agreement to coordinate basically up until the very end, 2011 to 2014. They would coordinate all the way until then.
So after 2014, the ability to coordinate, everybody's on their own?
Well, we're not in time anymore. We're not in disunity time. So it begins to dissolve their control.
Right.
Their control
right.
is based off of time. That's the fundamental
right,
axis.
Right, because of all the time wars and everything, and the time, and that all stopped.
If our belief of time changes, all their time is a microscopic piece of dust compared to the expansion.
Right, that's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
It's a pinprick.
That's right. And that just dissolves everything. It changes the whole,
the whole paradigm.
What about Fukushima?
This is an example of when the faction that's in charge of Israel and the faction that's in charge of the Middle East, which is two separate multidimensional beings, disagreed on how much they were going to put DNA off-world, how much they were going to get rid of people. Mm-hmm. When they do a mass die-off event like that, what they said 22,000 was killed on the news, they're just taking those people and selling them.
Wow.
Okay.
Okay.
It has a fear event dimensionality to it also. Right. So it serves all the purposes, but the Israeli faction triggered Fukushima to go off and planned the spin afterwards with the American medias, and the faction that was in charge of the Middle East didn't want that to happen. They wanted to keep it between Israel and Hezbollah. And all of a sudden, Hezbollah was neutralized for many, many weeks. Mm. It wasn't in the news.
Mm.
Hezbollah, the organization for Hezbollah, was infiltrated by American Resistance Free Earth people.
Oh.
And they needed to reassert power over that. That's why they wanted that event there. The Japanese people, which are part of the Oriental faction, were never told that they were going to do this event on them. So that caused a major reverberation against the Israeli forces, and many of their controllers were eliminated.
Ah.
So it was a fight between the two multi-dimensional beings, one who said, I need this fear event now, I need to milk as much energy out of the world that I can,
right.
And I don't care what you think.
Right, right.
That started the triad wars that we have now between the multidimensional beings.
Ah. Now, are they all at war with each other, pretty much?
Timeline war with each other.
Okay.
Manipulative war with each other. But at the same time, they're all looking at the light forces that are out there.
Oh, well, right.
They're surrounded.
Oh,
each
they
one
are.
Is the Hitler in a bunker right now.
Ah. That's a good analogy. Whatever happened to Hitler? Did he actually... Wasn't he pulled out of there?
There was a clone that was left there and burnt.
Okay.
He was brought to South America.
Right.
And then to try to access Hollow Earth, where he was rejected. And then sent to the astral world for recycling.
Ah, okay.
Because he was a part of one of the multidimensional beings that was designed to be a lightning rod for karma.
Oh.
Because that particular being needed to balance its own karma. So it put an evil piece really forward and created the war, and part of the evolution factor of the rest of the beings. But he was able to take all the karma, because there would be 50 years of TV about World War II and how evil Hitler was,
mm-hmm.
balanced that being's karma and allowed him to be more in the game than he was before.
Mm. But if he was recycled at the end...
A piece.
Oh, a piece. Okay,
just a piece.
Okay.
A sovereign piece.
Okay.
Remember, this is always a multidimensional game. They literally will sacrifice one piece to balance more karma.
Huh. Interesting. Okay, now what about the BP oil spill?
Ooh, that's a good one. That is an example of extra-dimensional entities that are players in the game, but no match for the 15 beings here, and no match for the beings that are enforcing the quarantine, but they have enough technology and enough balls to try to break the quarantine.
Mm.
So they can create an event that wasn't expected by any of the predictive models, and that they would be able to manifest their ships during that time to save the Gulf from being flooded with poisonous oil.
Hmm. Okay.
That faction is called the Jizk, J-I-Z-Z-K, Sada, a species of people. They're a mix between, we'll describe it as human form, 6 to 7 feet tall. Bone structure is essentially 10 to 12% denser than ours, but they still look like us. So they'd have more pronounced bonage. Sort of Neanderthal looking, but that's the improper word. There's just not a linguistics that describes it. But they have more pronounced face, and their DNA lineage goes back to one of the original 72 first species of Earth. And they do have a big soul family here, but they're a minor player, but they never chose to be a part of the 5,283 races defending us. They chose to be their own egoic force.
And
hero to the rescue force. And there are other species that are doing that also.
Mm-hmm.
There are many species that are on the mid to lower level, or even in the upper level, like the Zetas, whose sole goal is to be the very first species to occupy Dreamtime with the Dreamtime City.
Oh.
So they can pull their people out first.
Oh.
So there's a bit of ego on that level, because all these beings have been trying to free Earth, have been running their own program, separate than the master program that the main command ships that are here. So you have other operations in the light forces and the gray forces too.
And so in a sense, they're in relation to the larger forces that are assisting, they're like rogues.
Yes.
Okay. But they could be accounted for. But that all takes energy to account for what everybody's doing.
Exactly.
In every timeline and so on and so forth.
Exactly.
Except it's easier now with just the
one
timeline. So we should see an acceleration of... I mean, technically...
The word acceleration has too many 3D matrix reference to it. It always happens when it happens.
Okay.
Because the wavelength of total consciousness of Earth reaches the peak in the bell curve. And then it goes down again. And then it peaks again. And then it goes down
right.
again. And it peaks again.
Right.
And it happens on a peak.
Okay.
Doesn't ever happen on a dot. Always happens on a peak.
Okay. And we're in a
peak.
Yeah, definitely. No question about the super full moon tonight, mm-hmm. and then we started these interviews on the 21st, the solstice. Mm-hmm. The energy's definitely been, and I'm out Shasta on top mm-hmm. of it. So,
to add a little more to what we were talking about. The predictive models think there's going to be 18 peaks this year.
Okay.
So there are 18 positions in which all of the individual factions have to make their moves. And yet many of their moves are going to be countered. So it's what moves win during those 18 peaks determines the total value of consciousness for that year.
Oh. Huh, interesting.
Because each one is divisive or multiplicative of the consciousness. So if the forces of light win, they multiply consciousness. If the darkness wins, they deplete consciousness. The total vibration of all sentient life living right now here on Earth.
Okay. And according to what you're looking into from the Akashic Records, would you say that there's going to be an expansion of consciousness in general?
We've had 7 peaks so far.
7 peaks, okay.
So there's 11 more peaks to go during the end of the year. So that means there's 11 more attempts at fear,
right.
fear pointing right. versus consciousness expansion.
And then plus you have the random wild cards now that are
which
popping
are people
up.
Standing up and claiming their sovereign will and acting upon it.
And is the One People's Trust one of those things that was planted or seeded to divert? Or
just with any organization that rises, it will ultimately be
attacked.
Not necessarily taken over, attacked.
Okay.
It's the first time anyone's ever foreclosed on the Fed with the, let's just call it, the actual internet age. It's been done 20 times before where people realized the Fed was fake, it had no charter, the corporate system has no charter, our laws are our corporate courts, all of our bonded oath and bonded judges are under corporate bond, which is not state oath bond given by the President of the United States. So none of our judges are actually really judges. They're just corporate people.
Wow.
They all sell bonds for every case.
Okay.
So if you go to court, there isn't your name that has a bond with hundreds of thousands of dollars
right.
attached to it,
right.
which is then traded on the open corporate networks and actually traded on the stock market.
Wow.
And you can actually look it up.
Wow. And I have heard that when we're born with
you're born as livestock, actually.
Yes,
in
exactly.
the system.
We're traded on the
exactly. You're born dead, actually.
Huh. How does that work?
Well, as soon as you're this is how the American system works. As soon as you're born, there's a live certificate of live birth and then
right.
a birth certificate. The certificate of live birth is written in a way that you give away all your rights until you're 7. And you have to claim your rights back when you're 7, otherwise you remain permanently dead as livestock. Therefore, they can do anything they want to you. Because they change the actual definitions of that law for that law, and then other laws change the definitions to mean something else. And many, many, many laws do this. If people want to look up the most screwed up law, the one that allows Agenda 21, go look up H.R. 3474, the Regal Community Development Act of 1994.
Okay.
You will read in page 261 to 266 on the actual Library of Congress official PDF document, actually where they repealed every banking law from the 1930s to the 1994. And they repealed them in such a way that they changed the linguistics by 2, 3, or 4 words so that it meant something completely opposite of the original intention. And that is the document that is the rollout for Agenda 21.
Oh.
I've done dozens of shows on it.
Okay.
Dozens of shows.
Ah, interesting. So Agenda 21 is moving forward.
No, the Agenda 21, that's the law that got it to go forward. They made it
legal.
Oh,
okay.
That's the law that made it legal.
Okay.
Okay, as well as the banking scandal of 2008 to actually happen, made it legal.
Okay. So if the Fed has been, if we've gone through this so many times, then what's happening is it's just being altered in subtle ways so that it's reinstated.
Right.
Okay.
Remember, they're time traveling.
Right.
So they're writing laws that affect their time traveling that can be manipulated, but just by changing 35 words for one in one paragraph of a 1,000-page law. And then they have 35 other laws that have riders inside them that will all be affected, too, by the definition change.
And we don't have any access to the courts that are...
Right.
I mean, they're...
And in fact, the system of law that we have today will never allow you to completely load all of the laws that are passed into a computer that can do a network analysis on it.
Right.
Because it'll show that it's a multidimensional document.
Right.
That has time traveling concepts to it. And I challenge people out there to do it yourself. You out there.
So we're at the end of our segment for now. And
episode 13 next.
Yes. Stay tuned. Welcome back to part 13 of our galactic history. This is Lance White with Andrew Bartzis. Welcome again.
Thank you. An outstanding interview.
Thank you. I'm just astonished at the information that we're able to...
We were just talking about while we were on break is how fast that the information comes out.
Yes.
I mean, as an interview, have you ever experienced anything like that?
No. It feels like light speed. You know, I mean, it's just... it seems like we just start the segment and then poof,
it's over.
And there's the interesting thing is that there's absolutely no gap in the information stream. And, you know, I'm sitting here talking to you live and I can, you know, I know for myself that you're speaking the truth. So for myself, I know that I'm hearing the real, honest to God facts about what's going on, and that's something I've been looking for all my life, is just to find somebody who can say, yes, this is what happened here, this is what happens here, and only a galactic historian could do that.
Exactly. That's why I'm here now.
Yeah, yeah. So even if you weren't here, we would have to have created you. We would have had to materialize you.
Materialize it.
Yeah. So that in itself is a fortuitous timing. So all that we're talking about is very hopeful, even though we cover a multitude of events that are, you know, dark and negative and perhaps a little frightening. The very fact that we're speaking about them is
bright and shining beacon of hope,
broadcasting, you know, out and in and so on and so forth. So we were talking a little bit about the Federal Reserve and its control and the monetary system, which is an esoteric, it's a magical system, isn't it?
Your dollar bill and every other printed bill out there is in effect a spell that locks you into spiritual contracts that puts you into the system of monetary exchange for value and applies you to all the laws because the way the laws are written. When the Federal Reserve was created, it was a multidimensional effect that put the foundation piece that took over all the other foundation pieces of the monetary system worldwide.
Mm-hmm.
As we began to take gold away from the system, gold originally held our money. Gold and silver held our energy. The actual reserves held the energy. And those systems, the old way they would deal them, would drain the money out of the gold and give it to the system of domination and control. The gold was like giant crystal batteries. So they would literally take it out of that. Once they got the internet age and the telecommunication age, they didn't need gold. They knew it was coming, phased it out, and they had 20 years where it was all done on paperwork.
Mm-hmm.
And that paperwork was mined for energy. And then it went to a digital system that was interconnected to the internet, and there was instant repayment to any parts of the domination control system.
So they basically have carte blanche to do anything they want.
Correct.
And so does the gold have any intrinsic value?
It has many metaphysical and intrinsic values on a healing nature,
okay.
But its reason it's set up here is gold is a vital part of consciousness exploration.
Mm. Okay.
And that's what makes parts of our land very special, the amount of gold that's in there, because the gold can interact with your consciousness, which is part of the resonant field of the land that you're in.
Mm-hmm.
And gold is part of a mineral community and does have a spirit within it.
Mm-hmm.
But
right.
When gold is put into brick form in mass amounts of energy, the spirit of the gold is basically suppressed back into the earth, and those bars are emptied of the spiritual energy and only filled with the amalgamation of our exchange for value system.
Oh. So it doesn't really matter who's holding gold bars. It's That's part of the illusion.
It's part of the illusion.
So following the money trail and the trillions that are lost and the gold reserve.
It serves a purpose.
Okay.
Before, I believe in the last episode, we talked about $6 trillion of gold bearer bonds suddenly appeared out of nowhere. And this was reported on CNBC, the actual news. And what it was is they were bearer bonds from the 1940s or 1943. David Wilcox reported on this, actually.
That's right.
Quite a few times.
Yes.
This was for $6 trillion worth of exchange for gold for the American Federal Reserve. And three or four Italian bankers tried to go to Switzerland and cash all $6 trillion. Okay. That was a faction within the Vatican that was trying to save its banking industry and went into its basement and pulled out all these bearer bonds, which was gold that was stolen from the Asian countries during the Asian part of World War II. And you can read all this in David Wilcox's blog, and this is all true to the Akashic record.
Oh, good.
Okay. The gold itself that they tried to cash was to save the Vatican banking industry. If you look in the modern day now, J.P. Morgan Chase broke all ties with the Vatican Bank and then a week later had the whale scandal.
Mm.
That's in the news record.
Hmm.
The London whale scandal, where they lost $11 billion in a day.
That's one I missed. That
you can look it up.
Okay.
I challenge the people out there to look it up.
Okay. So the movement of the actual gold is probably something that
gold was needed to encase human beings so they can be smuggled off the world.
Right.
That's why they needed to get the gold currency.
Now, are there people that are holding the gold? Where is it now?
The vast majority of the gold reserves have been taken.
And
whatever is left now is what they're pulling out of the ground and smelting into bars. The whole reason they want your jewelry is they need gold to replace what's disappeared.
And so it's been just offloaded, it's been taken off world?
Correct. And which will be returned to us in an energy for value system in conjunction with the Earth hive mind and the hive mind sentience of all the other planets that are coming here to resolve karma. So there'll be a massive reserve of energy that people have been stolen from for the last 400,000 years.
Wow.
So there'll be a massive reserve of energy, not money.
Right. It's an energy.
Everything is energy.
Right. And so that could be the transformation.
Correct.
Yeah. And so we don't need to worry about abolishing the Fed or anything like that.
It'll happen on TV, but at the same time, there will be in no time for a lot of that.
Right.
So really what it is I don't think there's going to be a transition system.
Right.
I think we will transition and the system will be waiting there for us.
Right. That makes much more sense. And then those who need to have a gradual...
will have their time.
Will have time to watch television and say, look...
Time.
Right.
In separated time while we're in unity time.
Right, because we're in unity consciousness now.
Right. Well, we're still in disunity consciousness.
But we're in unity time.
Unity time.
And disunity consciousness. And largely run by our unconscious aspects, not our conscious aspects. So it's all about becoming more conscious.
Yes. And sovereign.
And sovereign.
In the realm that you're going to create.
Okay. Is there any truth to the... what is the truth about the Lyawanta Nisara fiasco? But the funds are coming any day, folks.
There are no funds. For any faction to make any move at that scale to say they're changing the system is a psych operation. Fear operation. Even if it's a positive light entity doing it.
Right.
It may be trying to do that to bring hope to people, but anytime you make a hope campaign like that, you should know down in your gut that somebody's going to turn it into a fear campaign way easier than a hope campaign.
Right.
But, you know, hope can be used on the dark side too. They keep pulling the rug from under them, making you think it happens. You're hurting them with hope.
Mm.
You're hurting them with hope. Stop it.
Mm.
Stop believing in it. It's never going to come. They're not going to give you any money. Money that's stolen and cannibalized from everyone else. You want that blood money?
Mm. Right. And all the trillions of deaths.
Because they're going to flood you with that negative energy money. And you think Nisara would be freeing?
Oh,
no.
It'd be more control.
Even
more, yes. In fact, that would be a very clever trick of a galactic group to, you know,
flood you with negative and energy
then,
money.
And then that's the, this is the new system, and here we're rolling it out, free money, everybody.
Yeah, free money, nothing.
Yeah, yeah, and just more slavery.
More slavery.
So, really, we're shifting from a material view to a multidimensional.
And those beings, like Leo, like you were mentioning, they don't, they either do or they don't know they're being used at some level.
Okay.
Okay. There may be parts of them that truly believe they're doing the right thing, but from my neutral perspective of the Akashic Records, of the big picture that's behind it, you're being used.
Yeah, yeah. And anytime we buy into the carrot, you know,
you get to stick with it.
Yes, right, right. And you were talking about the, oh, there was something that you talked about earlier, the slap on the horse's ass.
Oh.
I just remembered that.
The Syria war, the Iran war, all of that was the official, we'll just say, unbridled horse that somebody walked up to and slapped on the ass and it took off uncontrolled.
So these are events that are actually happening that are game-changing events. Instead
of the predictive model, and therefore they must make brand new predictive models that are nowhere near as accurate as the other ones.
Which means there's an exponential breakdown in the predictive modeling.
Correct.
Because the technology cannot keep up with
Correct.
Something with...
And they don't have enough spiritual people running the technology. Because too many of them are in domination and control.
Right.
Without full sentience to understand all the data.
And they're in competition with each other, and they're
internally and externally.
Externally, so that is really a
recipe for disaster.
Yeah,
Three Stooges event.
Right, right. So it seems like if one were to predict what was coming, and of course we can't, but if one were to try, it seems like there could be a lot of comical events that will be exposed through the media, and then also there will
the media will be a big joke.
Yeah, how will that? How do you see that unraveling?
Let me find the words for it.
Okay.
There will come a time where there'll be enough people marching that members of Congress will not be in the country.
Oh.
At that point, the corporate offices will have people camped out in front of them, and those people will leave the country, and the news media on the local level report it, and the national level won't. And that will be the main media issue, the local units that are saying, no, I'm going to give you the middle finger, I'm going to report the truth. And then the national units using their corporate powers to start firing people.
Mm.
Okay, so there will be independent news agencies that start their own internet news agency
mm-hmm.
for free to get the truth out. Bob Smith of Channel 7 News, who's now on Channel, you know, Z News on YouTube, continuing his show with the same production staff that said, no, we're not going to be a part of this lie. On a military level, there will be factions within factions that begin to try to seize control of the military for both good and bad,
mm-hmm.
because the fear with inside the military is the weapons.
Mm-hmm.
In a law enforcement scenario, you'll have officers who refuse to start arresting people because they're learning about the true sovereign citizen and what is real about their court system, because that'll come out too. Judges will be abdicating because there'll be major crimes against them.
Mm-hmm.
And then the stock market people, they will have the toughest time, the big figures that are commonly on the news. And then the talking heads of the news industry, both positive and negative, you know the big three,
mm-hmm.
they will have to face a major moment of self-reflection. Many of them will explode on air, suddenly be taken off air. Others will simply say, I'm not coming back, and they'll have to instantly replace them with somebody that doesn't have the same projective power over with propaganda.
Wow.
Therefore, the system just degrades and degrades and degrades.
And then that implies that the corporate lockdown and the figure eight of all these interlocking corporations will start to dissolve.
Correct. Many of them will simply steal from themselves.
Yeah.
And as they steal from themselves, they create the Bernie Madoff effect inside their own. And inevitably, the market that's controlled becomes uncontrolled because all these systems unfunded themselves by theft.
Right. Well, since everybody's stealing, you know, they'll all start putting their hand in the end. There'll be a run, you know, run for the hills.
A secret run for the hills.
A secret run for the hills. Right. But it will have its
effects in media and in physicality
that will be unmistakable.
Correct. Like when Congressman Joe and Bob and Dean suddenly decide to leave, and when the news agency goes to look for them, their staff says, "Oh, we don't know where they're at."
Right, right.
And then there's, you know, 30, 40, 50 members of Congress who got the early warning to leave because, you know, people are starting to say, hey.
Right, finally.
Finally.
Finally, they're standing up and putting their feet to the fire.
And that will be duplicated in Europe, too, and in Asia, and Japan, and all the major countries that have sacred geometry cities.
Where is it likely to begin?
In many places at once. It's a standing wave that's going to spread around the world multiple times.
Right. And that seems like that would be a fairly quick wave. Well, as you said,
Small waves with peaks and valleys.
Okay.
And
there's no way to predict it.
You can't give it to them all at once.
Right.
The humanity can't take it. It's got to take it in doses.
Okay. All right. A lot of alcoholics will be hitting the bottle. Well, they already are.
They already are.
I think people will be sobering up. I'm like, oh my God, throw away the bottle. So what else will be some of the impacts that we can look for as part of the signs that we're truly in the wave of awakening and
the dreams like I've described before?
All right.
It's going to come on subtly. And then people are going to go, where did this all come? And they're going to look with hindsight. It's been here a while. There'll be a lot of people that will deny their dreams, but how often can you deny your dreams if you're having them 4, 5, or 6 days a week and shit coming true?
Right, right. So that's like in a sense, it's like a bleed-through of the truth.
Yes.
And a dispelling of the illusion, mm-hmm. So people will start seeing what's really there.
So they can see no time.
Yeah. And that's led
no
by...
No social agreement time. No social agreement.
Time
we're living on is a social agreement.
Right, and that will, because there is no time.
There's no time defined as social agreement. There's galactic time, which is based off of your solar system in revolution from the galactic central sun, and your solar system is a sine wave that represents the total population of consciousness on a graph
okay.
of energy.
And then you said that Source was it was a neural network of the suns and the galactic central
Correct.
Suns. So we're literally in the mind of the creator, of Source, in a sense.
Everyone is, in a sense. That's just the way the universe is set up.
And in a way, we're like a holographic fractal of...
That's human linguistics limiting. We're spiritual entities that we create the hologram, and then we create a unity hologram. Then we all add pieces, parts to it.
Okay.
So it's all co-creation.
Well, I'm looking forward to the time when we have those two desks, the one and the other, and we can, you know, practice our skills. That sounds like
That'll
a lot of fun to me.
And there'll be other people that use musical instruments as their freedom.
Oh, right. And light, light.
Clothing differences, massive difference in clothing.
What are some of the other shifts that you see? Well, there would have to be a change in the internet.
The psychic parasites have to be removed from that's easy technology. Wherever there's a server, it just has a piece of technology that clears out the parasites.
Okay.
It's a neutralizer.
Okay. Because I see something. I see instant communications. Well, going beyond the internet,
it'll be consciousness transference. You're sitting here and you pick up your home telephone and another part of you appears over there and you hang up the telephone and go about your day while it does what you need it to do.
Nice. Nice. I like the sound of that.
I mean, this is the more advanced level.
Right.
You know, we as human beings don't have the operator's manual. Never got it.
Right.
You'll have an operator's manual, but you'll still have to learn it to get your final graduation party. And that's you putting the time to healing yourself with what's going on inside the machine.
And then that's the way to step on the accelerator of your own evolution.
Correct.
Is healing yourself and doing the inner work and
nurturing,
loving yourself and not just talking about it.
Correct.
And being the words, not just speaking them.
Exactly.
And truth.
And truth.
Truth. And transparency.
Absolutely.
So all these things that have been given lip service and have been reversed over and over and are continually reversing on us will be at what they...
They will be seen for what they are.
Okay. Okay. One of the things that I had heard about recently that, of course, we can't find anything about because it's all secret technology, is some kind of device in Antarctica that's 75 miles long that has been studied by Russia and China.
And Lake Vladivostok is its name.
Yeah.
And there's a device below it that's a 70-mile-long solid piece of metal. And that 70-mile-long solid piece of metal is an energy battery left over from Lemuria that kept the South Pole in alignment with technology that was in, let's just say, that version of those air cities. And that device linked in the dream times of the astral world to the dream times of the underground cities in Hollow Earth. So the Hollow Earth people didn't have to use intermediaries to function in the astral world for contractual purposes. That Earth's incarnation grid was much more free than when that device was created.
And is it still functioning?
Not for its original purpose, because the layer, it would be in the fourth fortification of Earth, of the nine fortifications of the astral realm through pyramid grids that was created. And that particular device, as I said, is to be a battery of energy that's linked into the all the snow that they knew was going to be there and the ice that created pressure on a crystalline structure that makes a massive piezoelectric effect on the entire bottom part of the pole there.
Okay.
So that gives the ability for that device, when properly activated through the control rooms, the ability to raise the consciousness of the Earth from the South Pole up, which can trigger unity, global dream time.
What about there was another piece that I read about the boxes that were washed up on the sand that were, and some of them...
All
over the world.
These boxes were devices similar to the ones that were put on Planet X, Nibiru, whatever you want to call it, to prevent us from remanifesting it in our reality. They basically, if propaganda were to be successful, the ground would be altered by some type of disaster. And these boxes at the edge there would absorb the wave of consciousness change of what it is and would lessen the actual damage that it did. And Fukushima is the classic example of that. The tidal wave should have hit America, should have taken gone all over, and it didn't.
Mm-hmm. And so they had removed the boxes?
Around Japan.
Around Japan.
So they could have that.
But what stopped it from becoming a...
Global tidal wave?
Yeah.
The other boxes on the other side of the ocean.
Okay, so they didn't do it the best.
They only removed the ones around Japan so the disaster could happen.
Oh, okay. All right. Was that a rush event? It wasn't planned out properly?
No, that was the Israel that did
it. Oh, right, that's right. That's right. We did talk about that. Are there other devices that we are unaware of that are left over from Lemuria? They probably all
kinds. There's dozens and dozens and dozens of dozens of devices, and many of the sacred geometry cities are built on top of these devices.
And probably,
like the device in Moscow.
Okay.
There's a device in the underground of Moscow that essentially allows the city of Moscow in its dream time consciousness to have a micro version of a control room.
Oh.
And that city can actually turn into I'll just describe it as a vessel of consciousness.
Huh.
There's stolen Arcturian technology that's underneath there, and it could take the consciousness of anyone that's in the sacred geometry and dump it into a unity drive, and that city could just ascend from our world and go to any other planet and then be co-located on another planet.
Wow.
And there are other cities that have similar technology like that, but they don't have the micro-control rooms to do it. It was a particular generation of technology that was so refined by a group of consciousness explorers millions of years ago that ultimately left Earth, but left that in that area. And as the reality reshaped, the technology was still there, and then people began inheriting and finding out more until... finally the Russian factions figured out what it was.
Oh, so they know how to use it.
And have used it.
And have used yes. it. So
during World War II, during the invasions.
Ah.
To get a mass amount of people off the planet for DNA trade.
Oh.
Because that's all that Lenin was doing. All the killings that he was doing was to get DNA off.
Ah, and so basically all wars are about...
Again, remember there's thousands of species out there that are near dead.
Yeah.
And will do anything for the DNA to survive their species. And you have a mafia charging an arm and a leg with interest.
Right, right. So they're in on all the technological advances. So they're part of the 15 families, I'm guessing?
The 15
beings
don't need families. They just need a breeding group. And there are other factions other than them. They're just the ones that are the best puppet players in this game.
Now, you mentioned once in the galactic history that goes back in the 50 million years the period, mm-hmm. that there was a 2 million year period when...
Earth wasn't in this universe.
Yes. Now, what about that entity? Was that a creator?
That was
god?
Another universal entity that said, time out in your universe. I'm taking that. Took it there. Did what it needed to do into Earth. Said, no, you're not doing that with me anymore. And it took out the rolled up newspaper and smacked that universal being on the nose and came back here and started up doing what it was doing.
Wow. So there are beings with that kind of ability.
Yes.
Okay. Now, essentially, we are those beings, in a sense.
In a smaller microform,
okay,
yes.
Okay.
I mean, it all goes up and goes down. But for right now, for this description at this point in time, we just need to know the bigger picture of our world.
Right, right. So that we can take back our...
sovereignty.
Right, right. And start acting like the...
sovereign beings with the power.
Right. Okay. Well, we're just about at the end of segment 13. Is there anything you want to add
good
before
now.
That? Well, then, we'll
be back.
We're back again with the Galactic Librarian.
How you doing,
Andrew Bartzis? This is part 14. I'm guest hosting tonight. Lance is taking a break, and I get to pop in and see if I can ask the perfect question.
It's all about the questions. So what kind of questions do you have for me tonight?
So I'm very intrigued by your role as a galactic librarian.
Mm-hmm. Galactic historian. The librarian is just another aspect within it. When I first began to understand its purpose, the records itself needed perception, and that perception is what ultimately showed me my role. So the role and the perception are one and the same. The sacred neutral perspective is the role that I play as a reader of the Akashic Record. The Akashic Record that I am mainly reading is the Akashic Record of Earth sentience. That is the total sentience that has lived on Earth as a physical body on the center timeline. There's above timeline and a below timeline. The Akashic Record is the center timeline. But the above timeline avatars all have sentience in the graduation timeline. So you can see the Akashic Record from the above perspective or the below perspective, but it's both sacred neutral, and it's what allows you to understand the graduation process. When I chose to be the galactic historian, I understood the sacred neutral perspective is how I needed to do all presentations, and the presentation is being able to connect into the Akashic Records from the sacred neutral perspective with the endurance to do it not in a trance, not medicated in any way, shape, or form, to have friends and family, to have loved ones, to have hobbies, to have a job. I still had to do all that as a function of the sacred neutral. And the more you get into the sacred neutral, the more you are connected to the sentience of Earth, the consciousness of Earth, that is saying, I'm a loving being, and these are all my children, but this still comes to an end. And you bring in the perspective of the galactic prime creator. Prime creator is neutral. It is neither polarity. Prime creator created polarity for his pieces parts to teach him about the micro world in the micro world below that, and the micro world below that, so he can create the world above himself, which is to create more galaxies or more universes. So the perspective is the role, because the role is reading the record in a intonation and a vibration that is revealed by the hearts of hearts to have connection to a vibration that is truth for one individual through discernment. Many shows do I say, use your own discernment. You know, there are people out there that channel one type of information. There are people that do another type of information. When people observe my material, it is like nothing else, because it's from the Akashic Record. And that's my presentation. And the role is the presentation.
So you mentioned earlier that you are the only Galactic Librarian living on Earth. Is that true?
In history right now.
In history, when you say in history, meaning since known
history? Akashic history.
Earth Akashic history.
I have the records of 20,000 others. And in the 20,000 others, as I said, there was only three previous galactic historians. And they all died horrible deaths.
On Earth or some other planet?
Other planets.
So this is Earth's first galactic in-resident
historian.
And when you read the Akashic Record and you're maintaining the sacred neutral perspective, how do you stay on course? How do you avoid from veering plus or minus, so to speak? How do you avoid graying the issue?
Just to clarify, there hasn't been a galactic historian on Earth since 28,000 BC. There was a galactic historian that came from somewhere else, outside of time, through a time warp. But this is Earth's first spawned galactic historian, which would be me, who said yes.
Incarnated in the physical.
To be here with others that also had the same choice. And there will be others that get the choice as the event comes, because our history is going to be so vitally important to our healing. Mm-hmm. To answer your question, how do you remain neutral? There is a mechanical function to energy. So when this is in alignment with this cycle, with this cycle, and with this cycle, all three are perfect spokes on a wheel, none of them missing anything. And that's how I know I'm remaining in the sacred neutral, because the way I read the record is in the neutral position. If I'm to this, it's like this waveform. It's just a stream of information. Mm. And you've been running the cameras, you know, before, when Lance, you've seen the stream of information. You're mm-hmm. able to feel it.
Sure.
When I say I create no time, it's because this wheel prevents the incarnation of time that's a social agreement from functioning with my thought patterns.
So when you communicate, if I understand correctly, when everything's in balance, it's like a wheel. There's tension going both ways, but as the bicycle moves cleanly, it's very easy to stay on balance.
Correct.
And so,
or ice skating is another way.
Ice skating, right? You stay in balance, right? So are you a referee?
No, I'm a presenter.
So you're not actively involved in saying, time out, you've done something wrong.
Correct.
And so if someone who was serving the dark, so to speak, or service to self, mm-hmm. could they ask you a question? And would you...
And they have.
And what is your obligation?
I answer that as long as that person isn't aggressive and isn't in my energy field and has a level of respect.
And how, so could someone say that you are a fully enlightened being?
I'm a human being like everyone else, with standard issues like every other human being in the system of domination and control.
Are you an ascended master?
No.
Are you enlightened?
I'm enlightened as everyone else is that's taken the time to master a skill.
Don't you have, though, with access to the full Akashic Record, isn't that unusual that most people, or nobody has access as you do? So that would, I mean, when we talk about information, if you have all the books and you can access all the concepts, you basically have an open book test that you could score an A+ on every time. Does that mean you're conscious or enlightened, so to speak?
No, A+ doesn't mean anything. Using the sacred neutral reading skill to pass a test wouldn't function in it. You'd be still turning over. I understand the breadth of your question and the whole width of it, and to give it that linguistical answer, it's a challenge, because we have so many things that limit how we can function. You know, to be an enlightened being is a definition in a dictionary that has an entire light worker industry's intuition added to it and things added to it.
Mm-hmm.
So, enlightened, this is the way everyone's supposed to be. Okay? There's supposed to be matrix intelligences available at our thoughts distance. If we needed the Akashic Record, it would read it for us.
So everyone can access the Akashic?
Absolutely everyone can do that.
Not only you.
You can make a medium to do it. To remain in the sacred neutral, though, is the path to get there.
For your job or for everyone?
For anyone that wants to read the Akashic Record.
And the purpose of reading the record would be to gather
spiritual contracts. It would be like Section 3 of the handbook. Or Section 2 of the handbook, how to read your contracts.
Oh, okay. So that it's basically, do you understand the rules for the game that's being played?
I understand the rules very, very good, and at times too much, because I can read the Akashic Record of the rules.
But for me, I would use the record as a way of understanding the rules and the possibilities, and how other people have used or played the game, and use like a biography. You watch
Correct.
Other people, and so you're giving them biographies of different pieces of what's happened,
mm-hmm.
like a story synopsis.
Correct.
So it's really not the end. To have a grasp of the Akashic Record is not necessarily the end result of my aspiration as a soul.
Correct.
Although, ultimately, as I grow as a soul, I may gather more information and wisdom.
Correct. And use it as a regular tool, as you would use a hammer or a cell phone.
It's like a resource. It's like...
Correct.
It's the galactic Google.
Correct. Galactic search engine, whatever,
right.
Google, whatever you want to call it.
Okay.
In my soul's incarnation, I'm so familiar with the drama from all of my past lives,
mm-hmm.
of living in every soul family and understanding the factions within factions of the soul families, all of this makes sense to me, and I'm able to put the paradoxical puzzle together.
Mm-hmm.
That's what makes the special human me, because that's, you put these puzzles in front of me, I put them together.
And how do you do that? I mean,
that's instinct. That's
okay.
On instinct. I mean, I can look at a TV broadcast and see the 29 layers of control behind it.
How do you stay in this reality when you have 29 other realities?
I've got other realities beyond that keep me anchored here. There's a joke I make. It's beer, pizza, and sex that keeps everyone here. That's what keeps bringing people back. On a more serious note, I have so many people trying to communicate to me in any given day. 300 to 400 easy in a given day.
Like by phone? Or?
I don't carry a cell phone because it never stops ringing. The number gets passed around until finally I just need a new phone. I gave up a phone 2 years ago simply because the energy from it was causing me horrible headaches and affecting me in other ways on a psychic level,
mm-hmm.
As we've experienced in a previous episode.
Right.
I like being here. I like doing what I'm doing.
Interesting. So the reason I ask is because I think there's a tradition on Earth of oracles,
mm-hmm.
and people go to the oracles for the answer,
mm-hmm.
which in itself, from my perspective, takes you off the path of self-knowledge, because you're giving someone else the power of your own discovery.
Mm-hmm.
Not that we shouldn't, in my opinion, connect to community, to source truth, because
mm-hmm.
that journey of solving the puzzle means, like a scavenger hunt, you're checking with different sources. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, you wouldn't have the answer for me. And if you truly were an oracle of a high level, you would never give me the answer, because It's inside, right?
Exactly.
It's inside. So your job is not to answer everyone's question about how do I get there. It's more about, so what part of the rules or what part of the history are you unclear about that's distracted you or got you entangled? As you talked about contracts that bind us accidentally or deliberately into agreements that limit our ability to grow in consciousness.
Exactly. That's a very well put. How would I explain that to someone that only wants to know the trivial stuff? How do I beat this? What's my right and true path? Mm-hmm. That's for you to do. That's your sovereign entity. I'm a sacred neutral perspective entity. I don't violate your sovereign free will in any way, shape, or form.
Mm. So discernment.
Yeah, absolute discernment. And in my readings, there are things that I can't say. I mean, there's a separation between what's an Akashic record reading and what's a psychic reading, but for me, they're one and the same, and I can use the skills at will. Mm-hmm. So what makes me different is I can connect the patterns that in previous lifetimes that this lifetime is dealing with. I've seen these patterns over and over
again. For a human being?
For a human being. Okay. Or for an off-world species, too. I do many readings for off-world species.
How do you do that?
Just look at them.
So
speaking
I couldn't.
Soul language.
I don't have that ability. Mm-hmm. At least I don't think I do. But you could have a conversation with another being in another dimension.
And I've done it frequently.
Frequently. How do they just ring you up? I mean, they don't have Skype there. How do they?
It's a psychic communication network.
Okay. And how do you gate the billions of other beings that want to access?
You're in collectives.
You? Okay.
And collectives hold space. And then all of the others in the collectives can get into that space, but only function through the main collective that's active.
Like comes to a point.
Comes to a point. So if I need to communicate, there's 1,200 options up there, but if I need a single point of contact to follow down the chain, mm-hmm. that's my single point of contact, even though I know there's thousands beyond them, still fully aware of exactly my communications with the single point of contact. Because it's a full collective.
So, in a sense, it's easier to work with the non-human because they line up in queue.
Yep.
And they're very polite, and you basically, mm-hmm. next, number 29.
Exactly.
Whereas the human beings, there's a lot.
And they forget a lot.
And they don't retain it, so they don't use their iPhones to record their... So they get direct access, but at the same time... It's not used always effectively.
You've seen people put to sleep from, or the energy that's come out in the
right.
fires.
Sure.
You know, when you turn that field of energy on, people's natural defensive systems turn on, like going to sleep or
TMI,
getting jittery.
Too much information.
Too much information.
Or go to sleep.
That's it.
Which we see on a larger society when mm-hmm. there's a topic that's just too sensitive for them to even engage in, and mm-hmm. they become almost combative, right? Mm-hmm. They become angry.
Or the opposite, sleep.
Or sleep, and just don't see it. It's very there, but they can't see it.
And that's why I speak in layers, and layers, and layers, and layers. And, you know, some of those interviews may be a little jumpy, but everyone's realizing by now that if you listen to the first three Walking Energy shows, or the first seven shows that we recorded, it's so layered that you have to literally... get to an understanding that everything that I'm speaking there is a layer to the next layer to the next layer, and I'm barely getting 20% into it. Hmm. That's how deep it can go. And it requires people to ask questions that are intricate questions. The Akashic records have been in me for as long as I can remember. Guess what? I'm tired of asking questions.
You've asked all your questions.
I've asked all my questions.
You've gone to the library and checked it out. I'm like... What do you want to know?
What do you want?
So is your contract, so to speak, just this lifetime, if you will? Or you've talked about the event, you've talked about dream times shifting. How's that role going to go past?
My particular role will go into that of a healer.
Are you already a healer?
I'm already a healer. I do healings frequently, several days a month.
Is that part of the job description of the Galactic Historian?
No, it's what I did to maintain the sacred neutral. It's the skill set that I wanted in my lifetime, that I wanted to be a Galactic Historian, that people would also know me as a healer and as a teacher.
So that was your thinking?
That was my thinking. Okay. That's how I'd maintain a life in a world of polarity.
And a groundedness in terms of
correct.
The humility that's needed to stay in the sacred neutral.
Exactly.
Because I would think that if you had access to all information, that it would be very hard for you to not think, you know, I'm smarter than everyone else here, and you could be very wealthy, you could be very powerful. I would think that you would be courted by everyone because you have the keys to knowledge, which everyone seeks.
That's the thing. I learned a long time ago you don't need to know everything, and then there's a point you realize in this dimension you can't know everything.
It's infinite.
It's infinite.
And you just go on lock.
Exactly.
Like in the cosmic lock.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, I think this is I'd like to talk about discernment in the next segment.
Okay.
Because I think that's the next step. And now that we have access to the Akashic Record in this day and time, which is quite mm-hmm. special, and you're now becoming more public mm-hmm. globally. Granted, you speak English, but I think you're going to transcribe all of these recordings into
multiple
English,
languages.
Multiple languages and Google, so that anyone can go through that and understand the concepts of it. So
I do have something to address sure. a little in discernment when we're here right now. I get people that come to me that want to read the Akashic Records, and they come with these specific questions, you know, this island here, this thing here, and you get other ones that just don't know how to use the tool. And I understand I'm the presenter, and the translation that I'm creating from it is maintaining the sacred neutral and in honoring the Akashic Record. That doesn't mean the person that's understanding it is misunderstanding it. So the difficultness of the job in answering trivial questions to one person is a giant question to me.
Because you have to answer precisely.
Exactly.
You can't just go, well, you really don't need to know that, so I'm going to give you kind of a shortcut answer, because yeah. that doesn't honor the contract of giving
the answer,
the most precise answer that you're capable of.
And what the person is capable of, too.
So you do size it.
Well,
you match it.
The person that could ask the question could be have been psychically influenced to ask a question.
Oh.
And if I answer a question that is beyond that person's comprehension with a linguistics that could reach them, I would violate their free will, and I would call that psychic vomit.
So
there are many people that do that within the light worker industry.
They're not speaking to them.
Right. They're speaking at them.
Right. And so they really haven't provided a service, if you will. And for you to feel good about your service,
mm-hmm.
You want to make sure the answers match to the ability to receive. So,
and that's why the layers.
I mean, if you send and they can't receive, no communications occur.
Correct.
I think that's called cognitive dissonance. So mm-hmm. you're not really helping that person, and you wasted your time in providing them with the insight they've requested.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Okay. It's been interesting. So we'll conclude this, part 14. And we will move on in the next episode to talk about discernment. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome back. This is episode 15.
15.
With the Galactic historian, Andrew Bartzitz. What a great last name.
Thank you. It's Greek.
It's Greek.
100% Greek.
100% Greek.
Yep. Dad from Corinth, mother from Patras.
Do you speak Greek?
No. That wasn't the primary thing in my family at that point in time doing the Greek classes, though I was an altar boy for St. Constantine and Helen in Cleveland, Ohio.
So you were raised here, but your parents came from Greece? Or?
They were both born in Greece during the war, correct.
So they're fluent in
Greek. English and Greek, yes.
And Greek both. You can't channel that from the Akashic Record?
I can't translate it. It's different. Human 3D languages are so different. They're designed to limit. Even the Greek language is designed to limit, though the ancient Greek isn't, because it has so many other symbologies behind it. But many of those teachings have been lost, so the record doesn't truly give the inspiration to speak it unless you've had a past life with it. I've had other past lives in Greek. The languages that I function with are more on a soul level or a galactic level.
Mm-hmm. So you don't speak in tongues?
Well, I mean, that's one person's definition of it, but you've heard me
I have.
Speak many times, so.
Is that soul language, or?
It could be a species-identified language, but I'm speaking it, and my throat chakra is able to telepathically translate it, so it's auditory.
So if I asked you to identify this, what would it be in that language? In English, that would be what?
The stone is a dream stone, and it has an energy field, and I was counting the different numbers, and then describing that certain points create a bigger energy field.
A dream stone, what is that?
This particular stone, we got it here in Mount Shasta. Mm-hmm. It is a dream stone. It's a crystal that came from a meteorite, and these crystals grew inside the meteorite under pressure, and when the meteorite crashed here, it left giant rock samples, and these survived the crash. Or they're seeded here from another world into deep into the ground, which is frequent. We get people seeding crystalline structures in the ground encased in a local bubble of reality that is the old planet that it came from, so other things like that can be naturally manufactured.
So you've talked quite a bit about dream times in our past mm-hmm. episodes. This crystal then brings a resonance that allows people to maintain dream access? Or
it aids dream access because of the points. Okay, you got all the, this creates an omnidirectional field.
So not just one, but the way they all work together.
Create an omnidirectional field.
As a community
field.
That...
Oh, correct. Oh. And then each individual has an omnidirectional field that ultimately determines how big and how wide the other is. So if I touch this crystal, I change the omnidirectional field. If I touch this one, where I go like this, I change the omnidirectional field. If you were to put this on your heart and try to go to sleep, the omnidirectional field of your heart is changed by the omnidirectional field of this. Okay, and as a dream, on a dream level, how do I put this? Your intentions take you to the dream source you're doing. Mm-hmm. This has the out-of-world experience, the separate of the matrix, so it makes it very easy or a simpler process to tune into the earth consciousness of dream, because that's where we dream, in earth consciousness.
So we were going to talk about discernment this episode, but you have brought up a really interesting question, and that is, what's the difference between dream time or a dream reality and the astral planes?
Big difference. Very, very big difference. In the astral planes, you have a lot more negativity that can exist there. Mm-hmm. In the dreamtime realms that are ancestral realms, there is no negativity. They're there out of true love. The astral cities have boundaries in them that allow true love to exist there. And then there are wild zones around it where there are no rules. When you set up something in the astral world as a function, like the astral or etheric satellites, satellite grids, they're physically not seen, but they're on the spiritual side, and they have a local reality bubble around them that keeps them protected, and then there's blank spaces of no protection, so entities can free roam there. Think of that as the most outer layer of Earth's magnetic sphere, and then the astral layer is that first 20 miles of it. So whatever can exist within the space between atoms is in the astral world there.
So it's like the Wild West.
Yes.
In the astral planes. Whereas the dream realities...
Very focused, very loving, and part of Earth's sentience.
So if I had you talked about having soul groups, so dream realities relate to a planet, or to groups, or both?
Groups who create places inside a planet's field of energy that's dedicated for dream time.
So it's another creative space,
yes,
that a soul group would create that they could decide the rules with.
Correct.
Could they be horrific places with a soul group that had, quote, fallen or was very dark?
That's a really good question. In the old days, there were negative places in the dream realm that served a purpose for dealing with the destructions of local realities, mm-hmm. because it was easy to snatch someone in a local reality you're about to conquer and bring them into this horrible realm and torture and abuse them there and then not have to get the karma for it. So many of those were taken out in about the 600 AD mark, where there are trillions of Dreamtime warriors just ascended onto Earth's astral realm and Dreamtime realm and just basically got out the weed whacker and started clearing all the paths and putting the lights up.
Okay, so now are all dream realities, is there a rule they have to be in love and light?
No, not all love and light. Some are education realms, so the rules are different, and you have to go through the experience, even though the experience isn't ultimately going to harm you.
School of Hard Knocks.
Correct.
And so are these dream realities something that I create, or are ones that I am given?
Well, in the ancestral realms, your ancestors were the original consciousness explorers, and they are the ones that set up the original space. Even though they may not even be living on Earth and any of their pieces, parts may be completely somewhere else, they set up the space, and Earth holds the space for that DNA lineage. Your DNA gives you the key to the door to get in.
Unique to this body or to my,
your
my progression,
soul,
my soul?
Your soul family and ancestors of soul family. So anybody that's been in a DNA lineage of your soul families may choose 6 DNA lineages, 12, 22, mm-hmm. but all of that number would be access to their ancestral realm. In dream time. Correct.
So my soul lineage, and that would be all lives that were lived by avatars of my soul and the group of souls called the soul family.
Correct.
And how many are in a soul family?
It greatly differs. You can have a soul family of 2 until they decide to have a lineage.
Does it always start with 1?
No, it always starts with 2.
Is that
you
like
have to have an elder. Those are the elders. The twin flame has been mistaken. We talked about that with Lance too. That the love and light community has really mistaken that's its actual purpose.
Mm-hmm. It's not a split of a soul when
no.
That's misunderstood.
It's misunderstood. A soul can split itself in 2, incarnate on a planet, and then come together and have a child, and then that child creates the soul lineage with the 2 parts of itself as the elder.
Mm-hmm.
This is where the love and light industry made their mistake. That's your twin flame, yes, and it's a male and female, but that's not what the vast majority of soul families are made up. That's extremely rare that some entity breeds with itself to bring another piece out like that. That's something that the cabal does through forced incarnation.
Mm.
Okay? On the other side, when two souls get together and saying, I'm ending all soul contracts with other soul families and I'm starting my very own, all of those other contracts are ended, and then those two come together and create a contract to make a soul family with a theme.
Like a partnership.
Like a partnership, yeah. And they're the elders. They are the starting elders of that. And whoever they allow to incarnate into that soul family through whatever DNA lineages they choose are a part of that theme that creates lineage, that creates history, that creates an impact into reality.
So it's kind of like forming a company. Some are not-for-profit, some are for-profit.
Yep, it can be broken down that way.
And the multidimensional beings are more of the for-profit.
Correct.
Whereas most others are not-for-profit.
Yeah, for service for others.
Service for others. So what's the range of soul group sizes that are here on Earth?
A lot of them have been broken down into groups of 8, 12, 16. There are quite a few out there with several hundred, and then a few out there with thousands.
Is that an old group when you say 1,000?
Not necessarily old. You could have a lucky young soul that just got into the soul family because there was an issue,
uh-huh.
and they have it. And then on other situations, they could be very, very, very old and have virtually nothing.
This is a fascinating concept. So it's like a club.
Yep.
And the club may recruit new members
mm-hmm.
if they need to. So a free agent, so to speak. Or if there's 1 or 2 and they decide they want to join with the other club,
mm-hmm.
the soul group. And the soul group grows based on, how do they grow? By recruiting other
expansion
members?
Expansion of consciousness within the theme.
Is that the monad?
That would be like the monad, yes, if you're the 7 ray readers, the first 3. Yes.
So it would,
Ray 1, Ray 2, Ray 3, yeah.
So the soul then is splitting into multiple aspects of itself?
Correct.
Okay, so that when you have an 8, that's 8 different versions, or let's say 1 divided into 8, so they have 8 times the ability to experience and grow.
Correct.
And so splitting into 8, 13, really is not important, because theoretically the 1 could do the same work.
Correct.
But with having more avatars, well, I'm just making this. Mm-hmm. So as you have more souls, then theoretically you could have more avatars?
Correct. Avatars within your soul family lineage that serve purpose to the lineage, like those that hold spiritual cords of equity, where let's say the 2 elders are going to go out on a consciousness exploration adventure and going to be gone 10,000 years. You would set up many people within the soul family would set up multiple aspects to be an oversoul seer and one that can read the contracts from the very beginning of the theme and use the earth sentience as the ultimate equity to determine if the theme has been broken or if the particular situation of contract removal is valid or is been written with scams behind it.
So if I'm tracking this, a couple members of the soul group go out on a journey and they're not going to come back for some time. Mm-hmm. And they're measured on their success based on these contracts they've agreed to, and those contracts are with the soul group or with God, or who the contracts are?
The soul family.
Oh, so they're saying if you go out and achieve your mission, your hero's journey, so to speak, mm-hmm. and you come back, then you'll receive
more energy from the whole.
And who's the whole?
The whole soul family that's expanding through their highest consciousness. It also applies when the whole soul family's on Earth. At times, only 1 or 2 members of the soul family can fully access their higher consciousness, mm-hmm. and then they can share that experience with the other soul family. And in the situation that we're in, the system of domination control totally separated us on the soul family level, so we don't have that completion. So when soul families come together, there's this rapid raise of consciousness because you're all fully sharing at that moment, even mm-hmm. though you're subconsciously doing it. Mm-hmm. And as soul family grows apart, one may be in high consciousness and can just share that with the others. Mm-hmm. Or if you have 2 doing, you share with the others. The whole grows brighter and brighter and brighter.
And so this concept of the soul family or the soul becoming more wealthy, I like that term you used, I think, in Walking Energy, these very wealthy souls. Mm-hmm. I never thought of that, but really energy is...
Is wealth.
Is wealth. And everything that you look around here is related to the sun.
Correct.
It's been converted into something that we use to measure in terms of value. But energy allows you to do more things mm-hmm. in the universe and experience and grow as well. Mm-hmm. So how do you become more wealthy in the universe?
Knowledge, experience.
So knowledge is wealth?
Knowledge is currency. Experience is wealth.
So there's no substitute for swinging the axe?
Correct.
You can't hire someone to do that for you.
Nope.
So these multidimensional beings that you've talked about, they've earned their wealth.
Absolutely.
And with that, they probably, like very smart people here on Earth, believe that they're probably better than most, and they can probably do things, and therefore they have more rights.
Correct.
And that they will take your rights away because you're not smart as they.
Correct. And you have no way to comprehend how deep their game goes.
Because they're so brilliant that you don't even realize what's going on.
Right.
But thankfully, as you've shared, there are some referees, and the Prime Creator wants mm-hmm. to maintain the balance. And so when they start breaking the rules, and the Prime Creator is aware of it,
mm-hmm. they get ejected from the game.
They get ejected, time out, and then potentially recycled. Right.
Or walk-ins taken over.
But the multidimensional being, how would they have a walk-in? I mean, their consciousness, how does that work?
That's the crazy part. When you make a sovereign free will version of yourself, uh-huh. there are limitations to your overmind consciousness. So you can put a walk-in in who's a psychic, who can understand... Well, back it up a second. The multidimensional beings have... other species that are part of the defense and quarantine here, that use high-powered computers, the highest artificial intelligence of one vessel, which would be enough to predict. I mean, it's indescribable how powerful that artificial intelligence. It would take 20 capital, the best Pleiadian artificial intelligences to understand one multidimensional being as a bar graph to create the data.
That's a lot
of
smarts.
That's how much it is. When we try to look at them, they're not even a being. The walk-in can come in and hold all the contracts, and basically he's just covering all the bases of what the being looks like, looks for on his checklist.
So these avatars aren't going to operate from this multidimensional being's direction, so to speak.
Right.
So as much as they want to go left, it goes right.
Correct.
And so they're like trying to go this direction, they're getting pushed this direction.
Mm-hmm.
And so once things are out of harm's way, then they're free to roam, so to speak.
Roam back again.
And so the question I think you asked before is does service to self qualify for, you know, extraordinary abilities? So granted you broke the rules, but it's kind of like Star Trek with Captain Kirk, where he changed the rules.
In the Kobayashi Maru.
Right.
He changed the rules. He still won.
Right, he changed
the rules. He still won, but there was nothing that said that you can't break the rules.
So somewhat of a metaphor from the multidimensional being.
Exactly.
Kind of a paradox.
We're in a free-willed universe.
So
rules are meant to be broken in a free-willed universe.
Or no one told you they could be broken.
Until you used your free will to break them.
Or you asked, can I break the rules?
Yeah. Exactly.
If not said, then interesting. So back to the soul group, and you talked about them being one, two, are they generally in multiples of doubles?
No, you can have souls that would leave it and give it at odd numbers. So there's no individual math that's for soul family. Though some groups use threes, nines, but that's the theme that they go. They come in pods.
I think I've heard the group of nine, a channel from the group of nine. So one soul.
And that would be a soul group. That would be a telepathic communication group that's using psychic technology to maintain a stream contact with an individual. I do group communications like that. I just don't present it in that type of format.
Mm-hmm. So you talked about earlier that what we're trying to do is bring these soul families back together, and that when they came into the incarnation grade, they were divided up purposely.
Correct.
So that they wouldn't become a cohesive, powerful group,
mm-hmm.
and that as a result, they've been blocked. Well, as a result, they haven't been able to really move forward, and then they've also been blocked as a group from graduating.
Correct.
And becoming, moving off, and then using that energy and wisdom to go do more things.
Correct.
Have we become more powerful, even though we've been stuck here, gathered more knowledge and wisdom, or have we been stunted?
I'll use a metaphor. A baseball metaphor.
Mm-hmm.
You have a bullpen, and that's all your pitchers. And if you know you're going to be going against two left-handed batters, and you've got two pitchers that can throw okay to left-handed batters, you pull those guys out instead of the ones that can't pitch. So the metaphor, I mean, I guess it's...
So we're not stunted, just we learned something different.
Right.
So ultimately, everyone that's been in the incarnation grid, this is a very unique experience.
Yes.
And so that in itself has a wisdom that's
uncomparable unless you're in it.
Of the whole creation. So you could argue that wisdom is quite valuable.
Correct.
Even though we've been grumpy about it.
Yeah, there are others that look at us as lotto winners.
Like we got to be in the most ultimate game,
mm-hmm.
and that we didn't expect it, but we won the lottery, right?
Mm-hmm.
In terms of wealth.
Yep. In terms of soul wealth.
So earlier you also talked about that we're bringing these soul families together, hence what mm-hmm. you're trying to do. And creating events, how do soul families come together? I mean, if
they naturally come together. I mean, when you make contracts, if there were no system of domination control in the disunity world we had right now,
right?
It's just say it got turned off. Soul family would just naturally migrate to each other.
Mm-hmm.
It's just natural. That's the way we're meant to be on this world. like you have a vine that's got grapes on it, and each has got a bunch of grapes. They all naturally, and you have a separate vine and a separate. Each one's the line. They all line up to the pods that they're supposed to be in.
So everything's connected.
Yes.
So
through the sentience of Earth, through your dream time, and that's how you all just know where to go.
So you don't get steered off path.
Correct.
So theoretically, if you're a soul group of eight and you have eight avatars, would you have eight avatars on Earth incarnated, or would you only have...
Most people come with one avatar on Earth and several dozen pieces, parts off-world, and maybe a few avatars off-world.
So,
but there's always a central avatar. And the central avatar at times can divide all its sentience equally among all sovereign pieces or sovereign avatars. And when he does that, he or she becomes a hive mind and can have even more pieces, parts, with contracts, feeding the hive mind, which is feeding the all as the higher self.
But here on Earth, if I was part of a group of eight, for example, then I would assume that there are eight incarnated humans here on this planet. Mm-hmm. And that the goal in this particular existence would be for us to physically know each other, come in contact?
To have contract resolution between you. First grade teacher, first lover, love of your life. Yeah, they're there to fulfill an experience.
We've agreed to come and help each other.
Fulfill experiences.
It could be my angry wife. Yep. It could be my really nice uncle, and so on.
Crappy boss.
Whatever. Crappy boss, right? It's really going to teach me. So as we move into this event and after that, will these people reunite?
Yes.
And will they... And so do they need to physically be in proximity to each other? Like, do I have to go?
Some will meet in dream time. Oh my God, where have you been? I haven't seen you forever.
In dream time, but not physically.
And then the dream will end, and they'll wake up, and they'll meet them the next day.
So they're all going to come together.
Correct.
So I'm just going to say this a couple times because it seems important, that if there were eight in my group, and those people were in ages that still ranged that they were physically alive, whether they were 5 or 81... Mm-hmm. That we would come together eventually in coexistence in our community, like in a drum circle or a school or...
Synchronicity would bring you together and allow... The Earth will allow the separations of densities and soul families to function through synchronicity. Unquestionable magic in front of you.
That's exciting.
Yes. We've seen it here at the event.
We have, but I guess I'm not trusting it.
Exactly. Until it happens to you 35 times in a week. At that point, you can't deny.
I guess it's kind of like the word soul family is used so loosely.
Exactly.
Like twin flame, you know, after like, whatever, soul family, like we're all family, right? Mm-hmm. But to say that there are eight beings that have done this incarnation things, mm-hmm. and you'd assume, well, maybe they're my family. Well, there's maybe one person in my family that's mm-hmm. on that team.
Correct.
And coming together so we all consciously know that we're a soul family, that we're now graduating.
Correct.
That, I mean, and we all know we're graduating, and then would we be helping each other?
Yes.
In that final step?
Yes.
And that would be making sure that we all created these dream realities and dream us together.
Or for your ancestors.
What does that mean for our ancestors?
If you decided to make a soul family lineage that would take on after you decided to leave.
Oh, I see. Okay, in terms of the next phase.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's been 25 minutes.
Okay.
And we probably need to, ponder that. No, I do. It's been just rich, very rich. Thank you, Andrew. I'm David Waterfall, and I'm with Andrew Bartschitz, and we are talking about real things that affect you, real people, and about how we're going to move forward in creating a new reality for Earth. So thank you.
Thank you.